Meet the Taylor family. They're a young family living in the greater Park Hill neighborhood. Like many families in the Denver area, they've been hearing about equity in education, and they're wondering what that idea means and how it affects them. To understand it better, let's look at life through the eyes of the Taylors. The Taylor family likes the Park Hill neighborhood because of its diversity and its rich history of fighting for socioeconomic and racial justice. They plan to send their kids to Denver public schools and begin learning about their options. The Taylors are assigned to a specific school based on boundaries drawn by the district, but they also learn that families have the option to choose any school outside of this boundary, even outside of the entire neighborhood, assuming their space in the school and the family can provide their own transportation. This brings us to problem number one. School boundaries are uneven. Park Hill Elementary, for example, has a very large boundary that has not been adjusted for size in decades, and it is over-enrolled. Meanwhile, just a few blocks away, Hallett Academy is under-enrolled and has no boundary, so its enrollment depends entirely on families who choose to send their kids there. Like Hallett, Smith and Stedman Elementary are also not enrolled to their full capacities, in part because of the impact of school choice. This is where we run into problem number two. School choice has unintended consequences. In theory, school choice is about giving families the freedom to shop for the school that best meets their needs. However, there are a couple of significant wrinkles with this process. First, we have to acknowledge that school choice favors wealthier families. Just to participate, families need internet access and extra time in their day to research and visit schools. And because transportation to and from school is not universally provided, school choice limits options for many families who can't drive their kids on a daily basis. Second, while school choice is promoted as a way to opt into a school that a family might prefer, it is often used as a way to opt out of the neighborhood school because families believe the school is bad or underperforming. The problem is that families are often basing these decisions on inaccurate and incomplete information, which leads us to problem number three. The school rating system is flawed. Denver Public Schools uses a rating tool called the School Performance Framework. This tool gives a color rating to each school in the district. Blue is the highest, and red is the lowest. The problem is that this rating system is almost entirely based on the results of standardized tests. The design of these tests tend to favor wealthier kids, and the average test scores of a school tell us very little about how any particular student will perform on a test. In fact, studies show that wealthier students' test scores, on average, are not brought down by attending schools with lower average scores. The focus on test scores means that schools are rated on a narrow sliver of the education they are providing. Much of the information parents say is important when choosing a school, such as teacher-to-student ratio, culturally relevant curriculum, authentic and empowered parent involvement, and racial and ethnic representation of teachers, is neither a part of the rating system nor easy to find. Naturally, this begs an important question. Are test scores that are highly correlated with wealth and privilege the best way to measure the quality of a school? Let's go back to the Taylor family. Unfortunately, they too were misled by this rating system. Using the ratings tool, they learned that the school their children are assigned to isn't rated very high. They never visit the school, and they never talk to children who are thriving there, both academically and socially. As a result, they miss out on all the qualities they were looking for in a school, and they end up enrolling their kids in another school outside of Greater Park Hill. This leads to problem number four. School funding depends on enrollment. Denver Public Schools are mainly funded through a system called student-based budgeting, where a school's budget is determined by how many kids are enrolled at the school. This means that under-enrolled schools receive a lot less funding than fully enrolled schools. When the Taylor family took their kids away from their assigned school, they took much-needed school funding with them, and unfortunately, they were not alone. In 2018, almost 700 children left Greater Park Hills Elementary Schools for another school in Denver Public Schools. The funding they took with them, which could have stayed in the Greater Park Hill neighborhood, amounts to over $2.8 million per school year. So, putting it all together, we see school enrollment is one big problem with several facets. First, the boundaries in Park Hill schools don't fit the school's capacities. Second, families are making school choice decisions based largely on test scores that reflect wealth and privilege. And finally, those with more privilege use that system to take their kids out of lower rated schools, which lowers the school's funding, making it harder for the school to serve the kids who remain. This can lead to even lower school ratings and a vicious negative spiral that results in more concentrated privilege and concentrated disadvantage. It's important to understand that affluent kids don't benefit from this system either. Research indicates that children who grow up in diverse, inclusive, and equitable environments are more successful, have greater empathy, and harbor less implicit bias, all without impacting their test results. So, what can you do? Consider becoming part of the solution. Imagine for a moment what Park Hill could be like if it had four high-achieving, culturally diverse, thriving elementary schools that truly reflected our entire community. Together, we can make this happen. Visit the Park Hill Neighbors for Equity in Education website to learn more and get involved.